Now you have a corollary. If we have function f1 belonging to R, means this function is R Riemann integrable, and f2 belongs to R, means this function f2 is Riemann integrable over the closed interval a b, and c1 c2, these are any two constants, then c1 f1 plus c2 f2 will be in R a b, means it will also be Riemann integrable over the closed interval a b. And integration from a to b, c1 f1 plus c2 f2 dx, it is written as c1 into integration from a to b f1 dx plus c2 into integration from a to b f2 dx. See here, it is given that f is your c1 f1 plus c2 f2, and we have for any partition p, spf is equal to summation over I fti delta xi. This is from the definition of spf, and it can be written as c1 summation over I f1 ti delta xi plus c2 summation over I f2 ti delta xi. Why? Because this fti will be c1 f1 ti plus c2 f2 ti. So it is equal to c1 into spf1 plus c2 into spf2. Since f1 and f2 are integrable, it is given here that they both are Riemann integrable. So for epsilon greater than 0, we can choose delta greater than 0 such that for all partitions p with mu p, means not p less than delta, we have modulus of spf1 minus integration from a to b f1 dx will be less than epsilon, and modulus of spf2 minus integration from a to b f2 dx is less than epsilon. If you take use of these two inequalities, then you can write modulus of spf minus c1 integration a to b f1 dx minus c2 integration f2 dx, it will be less than c1 epsilon plus c2 epsilon. So next, see here, it implies that your limit spf when mu p tends to 0 exists, and it is equal to c1 into integration from a to b f1 dx plus c2 into integration from a to b f2 dx. Hence, this c1 f1 plus c2 f2, this belongs to R, means it is R integrable over the closed interval a b, and integration from a to b c1 f1 plus c2 f2 dx can be written as c1 into integration from a to b f1 dx plus c2 into integration from a to b f2 dx. So this corollary is proved. Next, you have another result. If a function f is bounded and integrable on each of the intervals ac, cb and ab, where c is a point of closed interval ab. See here, the closed interval ab is divided into two parts, ac and cb, where this c is greater than or equal to a, less than or equal to b, and this function f is bounded on each of these in these two these three intervals. Then integration from a to b f dx is equal to integration from a to c f dx plus integration from c to b f dx. We have seen this earlier in our earlier classes, that range of integration can be divided into two parts. It is the same. Let epsilon greater than 0 be given as your function f is integrable. It is given here. On each of the intervals ac, cb and ab, there exists delta greater than 0 such that for every partition p, which is given as x0, x1, x2, so on xn, where x0 is a and xn is your b, containing the point c with norm mu p less than delta, and for every choice of points ti in delta xi, we have summation over the closed interval ac fti delta xi minus integration from a to c fdx is less than epsilon by 3. Summation over closed interval cb fti delta xi minus integration from c to b fdx is less than epsilon by 3. These are only because the function f is integrable in these two intervals, and some modulus of summation closed interval over closed interval ab fti delta xi minus integration from a to b fdx, which is less than epsilon by 3. Now we combine these three inequalities and get this result. But before this, see here, but summation over closed interval ac fti delta xi plus summation over closed interval cb fti delta xi is equal to summation over closed interval ab fti delta xi. Since this closed interval ab is bigger interval and it is divided into two sub intervals, closed interval ac and closed interval cb. Using these four, three inequalities and this equation, we get modulus of integration from a to b fdx minus integration from h to c fdx minus integration from c to b fdx is less than epsilon by 3 plus epsilon by 3 plus epsilon by 3. So this is your epsilon. It implies that integration from a to b fdx is equal to integration from a to c fdx plus integration from c to b fdx. So this part is also proved. After this, we have another result that you have to study two theorems. First is every continuous function is integrable, and second, every monotone function is integrable. First, we see this theorem that every continuous function is integrable. See, we shall prove that a function f, which is continuous on closed interval AB, is also integrable on closed interval AB. See, let epsilon greater than 0 be given. Then let us choose a positive number eta such that n into b minus eta into b minus a is less than epsilon. We will need this one. That is why we are taking this in this form. Since f is continuous on the closed interval AB, therefore it is bounded and is uniformly continuous on this closed interval AB. See here, this is closed interval and it is continuous. So it will be bounded and uniformly both, which implies that there exists delta greater than 0 such that modulus of ft1 minus ft2 is less than eta if modulus of t1 minus t2 less than eta and t1 t2 belongs to this closed interval AB. Now choose a partition P with norm mu p less than delta. Then we have capital MI minus small MI. It will be less than or equal to eta because from this one, see here, where I is varying from 1 to n. Therefore, UPF minus LPF, it is written as summation capital MI delta XI minus summation capital small MI delta XI. So this is summation I is equal to 1 to n capital MI minus small MI delta XI. And this capital MI minus MI is less than or equal to eta. So this will be less than or equal to eta, summation I is equal to 1 delta XI. And this summation is your B minus A. So it is equal to eta into B minus A. But this is taken as less than epsilon. See here, initially we have taken this is less than epsilon. Now, this is the condition for a function to be integrable, that UPF minus LPF, it should be less than epsilon. Therefore, the function, our function is integrable. So we have proved this also. You have, see here we have one corollary and remark. If a function f is continuous, then to every epsilon greater than zero, there corresponds delta greater than zero such that modulus of summation I is equal to 1 to n fti delta xi minus integration from a to b fdx is less than epsilon. This is our corollary. For every partition P, which is given as x0, x1, x2, so on, xn, here x0 is your small a and xn is your small b of closed interval AB with mu p less than delta, means norm of this partition P is less than delta. And for every choice of points ti in delta xi means closed interval xi minus 1 xi. Follows from 2, since the two number this, see here the two number summation fti delta xi and the integration f dx, both of them lie between UPF and LPF. So this is true, it means, so not to worry much more. We have a remark also. For continuous functions, limit mu p tends to 0, fti delta xi exists, and it is equal to integration from a to b f dx. You will have some problems, exercise or examples for the, or this theorem, and you can do it. We will have some examples to be solved here. See, some more students are joining the class. See here, note, continuity is a sufficient condition for integrability. It is not a necessary condition. It means functions exist which are integrable but not continuous. So if a function is continuous, then it is integrable. But if a function is integrable, then it may not be continuous. We will see some examples which will prove that the function is integrable though it is not continuous. It is all from my side today. We will have another class in your next class, next day. Till then, if you have any query, you just ask me your questions, raise your hands, and this lecture will be available on YouTube. Just go to my YouTube lecture and watch the whole video. If you have any doubt, any query, there is a comment section. You type your comments, and if you still you have any difficulty, you can mail me or WhatsApp me for all your difficulties.